Okay, let us begin our lecture. So now I am back to you with a different topic altogether, which is about crystallography. So we have actually four lectures in what traditionally is called solid state physics, or these days called condensed matter physics. The two lectures are more on the crystal aspect. So these lectures I will be covering, and two lectures which are more on the band theory and free electron theory aspect, that will be covered by Professor Suresh. What I am covering here is, first lecture would be on just pure crystal aspects, and the second lecture will be on the X-ray diffraction. So this is the way I am planning the two lectures. So let us begin with our basic crystallography. Now when we start discussing crystallography, we start always first with certain definitions. So let us start with the most important and most useful definition, which is the definition of what we call as a Bravais lattice. So let's go to the concept of Bravais lattice. Okay, when we talk of Bravais lattice, many times it's also referred as lattice, but you know, one has to be clear, because there can be also lattices which are not Bravais. I'll give you example. But let us first be sure that when I'm talking of a Bravais lattice in solid state physics, it is not the crystal. Okay, it's just a lattice which is a set of points. Okay, it has something to do with crystal. What it has to do with crystal and how do we generate this crystal, that we will discuss later. But as such, the lattice is not a crystal. Okay, it is also always infinite. You know, you remember, know that crystal is always finite. Okay, on the other hand, lattice, a Bravais lattice, is always meant to be infinite. Okay, you can always ask the question that if I am going to provide a link with actual crystals which are always finite, okay, why do we at all talk about an infinite lattice? Okay, that's a interesting question. The thing is that I have been telling, in physics we always start with the most ideal situation, and the most ideal situation is when you have perfectly periodic, or what we call as infinite lattice. Really deep inside the crystal, then it does not matter, because you don't see the surfaces. Only problem will comes if you are looking at some specific properties at the crystal surface. That's where one has to be a little more careful. In fact, surface physics has become a different branch of physics. So long I am talking the properties which is essentially in the bulk of the material, probably the surfaces will not be seen, and we can treat, we can sort of start with an idealized concept of an infinite lattice. Okay, so let's come back. We say Bravais lattice is not a crystal, is always infinite. Of course, it can be one dimensional, two dimensional, or three dimensional. When we are talking crystals, generally we will mean three-dimensional, but often it's sort of, to give examples, to explain the concept, we may use the idea of one-dimensional and two-dimensional lattices. Now, as I said, Bravais lattice is actually a pattern of points. It's just points which are filling the entire space, because it has to be infinite, so they fill the entire space, and not every set of points which is periodic will be, or a regular arrangement, will not be called Bravais lattice. In order that it is called a Bravais lattice, this set of points must have some specific conditions. So this is what I have written, is a pattern of points filling the entire space obeying certain conditions. Okay, what are these conditions? This is what I am going to tell in the next transparency. So the condition is that a Bravais lattice defined, that's what I have said, an infinite array of discrete points. Okay, they are not continuous, they are discrete points with an arrangement that appears exactly identical from whichever point the array is viewed. This is what is most important. As I said, I will give you examples. The basic idea is that, see, let us suppose you are sitting on one of the Bravais lattice points. Now, you have the idea of direction x, y, z. You know which is x direction, which is y direction, which is z direction. If I close your eye and move you to any other point of the Bravais lattice, then when you open your eye, you should not be able to tell whether you are at the original point or you have moved from there. The environment would look exactly identical. Remember, xy directions are known to you. Alright, so looking at the x direction, wherever you found points in the original condition, you will also find the points exactly in the new condition also, when you have been displaced. So it should look exactly identical as before from any point. You could move from one point to any other point of the lattice, and it should appear to be perfectly identical. You should not be able to understand whether you are in the same point or you have moved to a different point. If you have such a regular pattern of points, this will be called a Bravais lattice. All right, we'll also give you a methodical definition, but let's first understand this particular aspect. Now, for example, let's take a two-dimensional simple square lattice. Okay, here you have points. These are points. Of course, I have drawn, you know, somewhat bigger circle, but they are supposed to be points. All right. Now, and of course, you assume that they are infinite. It means they keep on moving exactly. Exactly, this pattern is repeated in this direction, in this direction, in this direction, and in this direction, because this is two-dimensional. So we are talking of only two-dimensional space. So you have exactly similar type of pattern filling entire space in two dimension. Okay, this direction. So I have just shown only a few of points, but let's imagine that these points are sort of infinite. So you have points everywhere in the two dimensions. Now, as if you are suppose sitting on this particular point, you will find out that, let's suppose we call this direction as x direction and this direction as a y direction. So in the x direction, and let's suppose this distance is a, you will find out that distance a, you find another point. If you move along y direction, you will find another point at a distance of a. If you move in I plus j direction, where I and j are unit vectors along the x and y direction, then at a distance of root 2a, you will find the point. Now, if I move you from this particular point to this particular point, nothing will change. Here again, at a distance of a along the x direction, you will find a point. Along the y direction, at a distance of a, you will find a point. Along I plus j direction, you will find a point at a distance of root 2a. Because this is supposed to be infinite, so if I have moved myself from here to here, I will not find any difference. To me, everything would look exactly identical as before. So I will not be able to tell whether this is the original point or whether I have moved from that particular point to a different point. So this set of points is what we call as a Bravais lattice. Let's take another example, what we call as a two-dimensional centered square lattice. So earlier we had only these points, now we have another point here, in between here. Okay. It may appear to you initially that this point is differently located from these two points, because this point is at the center of a square while these points are at the corner of a square, but it is not correct, because here this particular point can also be looked as a corner point of this square. This what I have plotted as a red square, and this point which was earlier appeared to be at corner of this black square will now appear to be at the center of this particular red square. So depends on how you look, any point of this lattice can also can be thought as a point on the center or on the a point on the corner. Again, I repeat, if I move from this particular point, I will find a point at a distance of 2a here, at a point of this at a distance of root 2a here. If I move from this particular point to, let's say, this particular point, exactly identical will happen. At a distance of 2a in this particular direction, I will find a point. At a distance of root 2a along this particular direction, I will find a point. So if I move from this particular point to this particular point, or for that matter from this point to this particular point, or this particular point to this particular point, or this point, you will find the environment to be exactly identical. This also sometimes we call as a translational symmetry, because if you translate from one particular point to any other point, you find everything is 100% symmetrical, is exactly like before. Okay? It doesn't appear to you that you have changed your position. So this is what we call, remember, you have to move from one particular point to another point. Okay? So this two-dimensional centered square lattice also forms a Bravais lattice in, of course, two dimension. As I said, a lattice, a Bravais lattice can be in one dimension, two dimension, three dimension, the way, I mean, depends on your problem. Now let's take an example of a non-Bravais lattice. See, here we have set of points which are like this, okay, which are also regular, and let's assume that they are also infinite. It means you have exactly similar pattern which is being followed everywhere, okay, right from minus infinity to plus infinity along the x direction, right from minus infinity to plus infinity in the y direction. So this is also an infinite set of pattern. This is also a regular pattern, because you have exactly the same pattern which is being, you know, sort of translated every time. But however, there is a difference. I could call this is a lattice, but I will not call it as a Bravais lattice, because if I move from this particular point to this particular point, then definitely my environment has changed. Because if I am sitting on this particular point, if I move along this particular direction, let's call this small distance as x. At a distance of x, I will find a point. But if I am moving from this particular point to this particular point, at a distance of x here, okay, I will not find a point. Means definitely I will be able to tell, because if I am sitting on this point, I will find it out that along this direction, at a distance of x, there is a point. If I am sitting on this particular point, I do not see a point at distance of x. So, I will definitely be able to tell that I am not in the original point, but I have moved my position. Okay. So, these set of points do not form a Bravais lattice. Let us take one more example of a slightly more regular structure, okay, which also does not form a Bravais lattice, and that is actually a very, very interesting type of structure, which we call as a honeycomb lattice. In fact, I am using the word lattice. Let us also be little clear, when we use the word lattice, sometimes we do not use very, very appropriately in talking. I mean, many times in the crystal we said what is the lattice type, okay, which you always mean Bravais lattice type. Okay. A thing which is non-Bravais in principle can also be called lattice, but generally we sort of avoid that particular word. Though, I mean, in principle, if you go strictly by definition, okay, these lattices can still be called lattices, but they are not Bravais lattices. But often when we are talking of solid state physics, because we are we will normally be dealing only with Bravais lattices, so we just most of the time remove the word Bravais and we say what is the lattice type of a particular material. So, I mean, depending upon the reference to context, one should be able to judge what I mean, whether I mean a Bravais lattice or I mean a non-Bravais lattice. Okay, so this is a honeycomb structure. You can see these are hexagons, these are points which are at the corner of hexagons. So, there is one point here, there is one point here, there is one point here, like this. Then, see, this is also a very regular arrangement. This is filled at the entire space like this. This, I insist that this does not form a Bravais lattice. If, for example, if you are looking at this particular, if you are sitting at this particular point, here you find, let us call at the distance of A one particular point, and then you find whatever is, this is also a distance A, but whatever is this angle in this particular direction, a point at a distance A, from here another point at a distance of A. Now, if I move from this particular point to this particular point, here I do not see at a distance of A another point, here I do not see at a distance of another point. So, clearly the environment has changed. In fact, it is very, very interesting in this particular thing, because you will realize that as I move from this particular point to this particular point, actually my environment has turned by 180 degrees, because what was x axis, okay, I will observe exactly the same thing in minus x direction, okay, because in the x direction there was a point at distance of A here, now in the distance of minus x there will be a point at distance of A, okay, while there was no point here, but now you will find a point here. So, it appears as if the environment has rotated when I have moved from this particular point to this particular point. But remember, the condition of a Bravais lattice is that the environment should look exactly identical. Even if it is rotated, that is not acceptable as a Bravais lattice. So, this does not form a Bravais lattice. Okay. Let me just tell you, for your interest, you can satisfy yourself, if there was a point here at the centers of all these hexagons, then that will form actually a Bravais lattice. In the absence of that particular point at the center, this does not form a Bravais lattice. This we call as a honeycomb structure or honeycomb lattice, which is not a Bravais lattice, but if I put the points at the centers of this hexagon, this will form is what we call as a hexagonal Bravais lattice. Now, let us look at the more mathematical definition and more useful definition as the entire solid state physics is concerned, and this is what I am calling as an alternate definition. This definition has been given for a three-dimensional lattice, okay. This can easily be extended to two-dimension and one-dimension if we are interested in, okay. How, we will see, but let us first just take a proper mathematical definition of a three-dimensional Bravais lattice, okay. Now, I will not show, but it can be seen that the two definitions which I have given, the first definition about the environment and the second definition, which is a more mathematical definition, okay, they are identical. Okay. So, let us assume that we have three vectors A, B and C, and because we are talking of three dimensions, they should not be in the same plane. Okay. So, vector A, B and C are not, there are three vectors which are not in the same plane. Now, take a linear combination of these vectors, which we call as a translation vector T, as n1a plus n2b plus n3c, where n1, n2, n3 are integers which could be positive, negative or 0. Now, keep on giving various values of n1, n2, n3, okay, right from minus infinity to plus infinity, but they have to be integral values, okay, you will get a set of infinite translational vectors, okay, or infinite position vectors. Now, at the position at the tip of these vectors, you put a point, okay, these particular points will form what we call as a Bravais lattice. So, a Bravais lattice can be generated with the help of three vectors, which we call as primitive vectors. These are called primitive vectors, which generate a given Bravais lattice. Of course, these three primitive vectors should not be in the same plane. Okay? So let me read. A three-dimensional Bravais lattice can also be defined as a set of all points, the position vectors of which are given by t is equal to n1a plus n2b plus n3c. Here, n1, n2 and n3 are integers, positive, negative or 0. The vectors a, b and c are not in the same plane and are called primitive vectors of the lattice. They generate infinite set of points forming the Bravais lattice. So, in principle, I can even look at the other way, and for every Bravais lattice, I could find what are the primitive vectors. Let's take some example of three-dimensional lattices. This is probably one of the most common and simple three-dimensional Bravais lattice, which we call as a simple cubic lattice. Okay, in order to imagine this, we always assume that there is a cube. Of course, there are no points here. The points are only at the corners of these cubes. Okay, these lines have been drawn just for making our thought process a little simpler. So you have, let's assume this cube, and this cube is, let's suppose, is translated everywhere in three dimension from minus. So you have similar type of cube. No, there's another cube which is just touching this particular cube, exactly identical cube. Okay. In this direction, and of course, in the third direction. So, in all the three directions, you know, you have exactly similar type of cube which has been repeated from minus infinity to plus infinity. Now, all the points which are, points are only at the corners of the cube, okay, these points that I will generate will form a Bravais lattice. And the primitive vectors of this particular Bravais lattice is written as A times, a vector A will be A times I plus and b is a times j and c is a times k. I, of course, a is same here because this is cubic lattice. So, this length and this length are all the, these three lengths are same. So, we have only a, only these vectors, their directions are different. One is, let us say, in this particular direction, another is particular direction, third in this particular direction. So, these are the primitive vectors which generate this simple cubic lattice. Now, let us look at another cubic lattice, which we call as a body-centered cubic lattice. It's like in two dimension, we could consider a centered square lattice. We can consider a centered cubic lattice in which, in addition to these points which are on the corner, there is also one particular point at the center of this particular cube. All right. Now, these are the primitive vectors of this particular body-centered cubic lattice. Let me just tell you that for the same lattice, there can be multiple ways of writing the primitive vectors. There is no unique way of writing primitive vectors. Unfortunately, because of symmetry in crystallography, some of these things are not, are somewhat ambiguous. So, in fact, what you could show that if I take primitive vectors as ai plus aj plus a by 2 I plus j plus k, this will also would have served as a proper primitive vector for body-centered cubic lattice. But on the other hand, we normally like to take a better symmetrical type of primitive vectors. Okay, we do not want specifically to be preferential or biased towards x, y directions. Okay, so, we generally write the primitive vectors of this particular type of Bravais lattice as a is equal to a by 2. See, it is easier to remember when you are talking of the first lattice, it is the first one which is negative sign, second and third has positive sign. When I am writing the second primitive vectors, it is the second one which has negative sign, first and third have positive sign. When I am writing the third vector, it is the third one which has negative sign, and first and second are having positive sign. Okay? Now, unfortunately, because there is always a three-dimensional thing involved, which is not always easy to write on transparencies or on chalkboard, I always tell students that you imagine that you are sitting in a room, whatever is your room is assumed to be a cube, then you start imagining that particular cube. So, what you will say that this particular point, which is saying minus I plus j plus q, if let us say this is x direction, this is y direction, so you are going in negative direction, so you are going to a neighboring room like that, and because j and k is positive, this is supposed to be j and this is supposed to be k. So, this particular point starts from this particular origin and goes to the center of the neighboring room. So, similarly, these ABC can be defined as the position vectors of similar type of cubes which are in the neighboring cubes. Okay? It is much simpler to think that you are sitting in a cubical room and you have a sort of infinite array of rooms in all the three directions, and then try to visualize these things and imagine these things and then draw these vectors. The next lattice that we are going to talk about, or next Bravais lattice that I am going to talk about, is what you call as a face-centered cubic Bravais lattice, which is the one which I am giving here. Okay, here there is no point at the body center. Okay, you have points, of course, at the corners of the cube, but then you have, remember, in this particular room, if you look, you will have six faces, four faces, there are four walls. One is ground, another is roof. So there are six things, 1, 2, 3, 4, and this is roof and this is your ground. Okay, so there are six faces inside a cube, and each of these faces is centered. So here, if you look at the roof, roof is also centered. If you look at your ground, the ground is also centered. Then you look at all the four walls, all these four walls are centered. So all, there are six faces, and all these six faces are centered. Okay, so this is what we call as a face centered cubic lattice. In this case, of course, you can write the primitive vectors as this, and in this case, when you are writing the first one is missing, I is not there. When I am writing the second one is missing, that is J is not there, so you have K plus I. When I am writing the third one, that is K, is not there. So when I am writing A, is A by 2, J plus K, I does not appear. When I am writing B, is A by 2, K plus I, J does not appear. If I am writing C, is A by 2, I plus A. You can again visualize if this is your origin. Okay, if I am writing this x y direction, this is y direction, I plus j divided by 2. So this is the vector joining from this particular point to this particular face center, which will be one of the primitive vectors. Similarly, when I am writing j plus k, this is j plus k. So a vector joining from this particular point to this particular point here at this center, this is what will be called the second primitive vectors. Okay, this I leave as an exercise that you take a linear combination and find, let's say, position vector of this particular point as a linear combinations of I, A, B, C. So you can satisfy yourself that by taking appropriate values of n1, n2, and n3 from these primitive vectors, you can reach this particular point, reach this particular point, this point, this point, or any other point of the lattice when this is your origin. All right. So these are the primitive vectors of what we call as a face-centered cubic lattice. Now, next important concept is what we call as the concept of basis. So we started from a set of points. Now, what do I do with these set of points? These set of points, I associate certain thing with these points. This, whatever we associate with these points, that is what we call as a basis. Now, the concept of basis is a little more general. There are many ways in which basis can be used, and is the concept of basis is useful. But thing is that you start with a Bravais lattice, and then each of the lattice point you try to associate something. You associate either different set of points, or eventually you associate atoms or a set of atoms to generate crystal structure. Okay, so basis is something which is being used, which is being associated with each point of the lattice. I will give you the example, but let us just see there are three ways in which there are three usefulness or three concepts where we use the idea of the Bravais lattice. First, often we come across lattices which are not Bravais. For example, I have given you the example of honeycomb structures and some other, when there is another structure, I give you example, which are non-Bravais lattice. All right. Now, what you can do, you can start from a Bravais lattice, and by associating two or more points at each of these, you may be able to generate a non-Bravais lattice. Or in other words, if I started with a non-Bravais lattice, I can convert this to a Bravais lattice by taking more number, two or more number of points as being associated with each of the Bravais lattice. I will give you an example. The second thing where, second place where we use the concept of basis is when I want to convert a basis lattice, a Bravais lattice, to a simpler Bravais lattice. See, we start with a lattice which is also a Bravais lattice, okay, but this I want to convert into a simpler lattice because I want to emphasize certain type of symmetries, and then I convert one Bravais lattice to another simpler Bravais lattice. So one way is that convert a non-Bravais lattice to a Bravais lattice. Okay. Other thing is that convert a Bravais lattice also to a simpler Bravais lattice by using the concept of basis. It means you start with a simpler Bravais lattice, at each of the points you associate certain number of points exactly in identical way. What is important here is that whatever is your associating basis, the exactly the same basis must be associated at each of these lattice points, at each of these Bravais lattice points. Okay. Now the third thing, which is where we come into picture, is that you put an atom or set of atoms, ions or whatever it is, set an atom or set of atoms exactly in identical fashion, okay, at each of these points of the Bravais lattice to generate an ideal crystal. I am using the word ideal crystal because, as we know, that crystals, I mean, a realistic crystal is never 100% ideal. If nothing else, at least it will have surfaces, you cannot make it infinite, okay. But even you will always find certain defects in crystals. A normal crystal will never be 100% perfect. So, this is the reason I am using the word that this is to generate an ideal crystal. And as I have said, in solid state physics, you start always with an ideal thing. And in solid state physics, we always start with an ideal Bravais lattice. And then only we discuss the physics. You know, it produces certain amount of simplicity in the way we understand the condensed matter physics or solid state physics if we start with this concept of an ideal Bravais lattice. Okay, let's give examples of these particular type of all the three things. So, this is one non-Bravais lattice that we have talked. Now, consider these two points as one set. Now, instead of this particular point, take any point, doesn't matter. For example, take this particular point. Now, what you say that you forget about another second point, you just take only one point. This, as you know, is a square lattice. Now, at each of the Bravais lattice points, you associate two points, one here, another at this particular distance, let's say minus I minus j, at a distance of x. Starting from a Bravais lattice, at each of the lattice points, I started putting two points, one at the original. Let's say first we take this point as the origin, I put one point itself there, another point here at a distance of x in direction minus I minus j. Okay. Then these two points form the basis. Starting from a square Bravais lattice, by putting two points, one at the origin, another at this particular point, I will be able to generate this type of non-Bravais lattice structure. Similarly, you go to this particular point, now again you take your origin, take this point as origin, put one point at origin, another point you put at a distance of x at minus I minus j direction, okay, you will get this particular point. You take this particular point as origin, put one point itself there, another point at a distance of minus a by 2 I plus j. Okay. So, this non-Bravais lattice, okay, can be looked as a Bravais lattice with two points basis. Now, let us look at the honeycomb structure. Honeycomb structure is exactly identical situation. Okay. You take these two points, these set of two points, consider them together. Okay. You can see that this generates is what we call as a simple hexagonal lattice. Okay. In fact, I had told you that if you have a hexagon and you have one particular point at the center, okay, then that does form a Bravais lattice. So, you, for example, you can take whatever you want to take this particular point, you take this particular point, you take this particular point, okay, you take this particular point. Okay, look only one of these points and put exactly identical, you point this particular point thing and this particular thing, then you go to this, you put this particular point here, you go to this, you put exactly in a similar fashion this particular point, you will be able to generate what we call as overall hexagonal Bravais lattice. So, you start from hexagonal Bravais lattice, okay, and at each point of this lattice, you start putting two points, one here, another here, one here, another here, starting from a hexagonal Bravais lattice, you will be able to generate this honeycomb structure. So, honeycomb structure can be looked as a Bravais lattice, which is hexagonal, simple hexagonal Bravais lattice with two points basis. Now, conversion of a lattice, this is something which I leave this as an exercise to you, but you can look into it. That let us look at body centered cubic lattice. I have already defined what is a body centered cubic lattice. You start with a simple cubic lattice, then in simple cubic lattice, you start putting one point at the origin and another point at a distance of a by 2 I plus j plus k. Let me just write this thing to make it clear. Remember, I plus I j k are unit vectors along x direction, y direction and z direction. So, you start with a simple cubic lattice. Okay. Then you take a by 2 I plus j plus k, this is the point which will lead you to body center. So, this was my simple cubic lattice. where you have points at each corners. Okay. Now, let us suppose we take a particular point here, put one particular point here, another point at a by 2 I plus j plus k. If I move half the way here, half the way here and half the way here, I land up at the center of this particular cube. Okay. So, you put one point here, one point here. Then you go here, you put one point here, another point there. You put one point here, another point here. So, from this simple cubic lattice, by taking two points basis, I will be able to generate a body centered cubic lattice. So, a body centered cubic lattice can also be thought as a simple cubic lattice with two points basis. So, remember, body centered cubic in its own self is a Bravais lattice, simple cubic lattice also is a Bravais lattice, but simple cubic lattice is comparatively simpler. So, many times I would rather like to call body centered cubic lattice as a simple cubic lattice with two points basis. This is often done in crystallography, because if we start with a simple cubic lattice, things become somewhat easier. So, often in the case of crystallography, when I am looking at the crystal structure using X-rays, I rather prefer to represent a body centered cubic or a face centered cubic lattice with a simple cubic lattice with multiple number of points basis. Okay, let us go to the next one. Similarly, a face centered cubic lattice can be thought of as simple cubic lattice with 4 points basis. So, if you take a simple cubic lattice and start putting 4 points at each of the point, one will be at origin. Okay, let me just write this also. If you put one particular point, start with a simple cubic lattice, put one particular point at the origin, another point you put at a by 2 I plus j, third point you put at a by 2 j plus k, and fourth point you put at a by 2 we start from a simple cubic lattice, then at each point you start putting 4 points, one at that point itself and another 3 points at the position vectors which are given here. Okay, you can assure yourself that what you will get will be exactly a face centered cubic lattice. So, a face centered cubic lattice can be thought of as a simple cubic lattice with 4 points basis. Now, create a crystal structure, that is the third use of the basis. See, often we say, for example, iron at room temperature has a BCC structure. When I say, this is again, a simple way of putting it. When I say iron has a BCC structure or a BCC lattice, what it means that you start with a body centered cubic lattice and put one atom of iron at all these points. Remember, the atom is supposed to be much bigger. Okay. So, often we show this structure in like points. Okay, it's not really point. The atom is not like a point. No atom has much bigger. In fact, as we'll be discussing, it's much more simpler to consider an atom as a sphere, okay, or a much bigger object. So sometimes, people always get confused. Students get confused that these points are atom and they are essentially hanging with one particular line in between. That's not really the correct picture. Okay, see, what we are representing when we are representing BCC structure is only those points. The points at where the center of these particular atoms could lie. Okay. So, when we say iron has a BCC structure, it means if you start with a BCC lattice and put one atom at each of these points, you will generate an ideal iron structure. Similarly, a sodium chloride can be thought of as a face centered cubic lattice with 2 atoms basis. This I have found that a very large number of students and many times teachers are sort of confused, because of some funny reason, because they always feel that sodium chloride is a simple cubic structure. Remember, if we want to talk of a Bravais lattice, everything is to be identical. In sodium chloride, yes, if sodium and chlorine would have been exactly same atoms, this would have formed a simple cubic structure. Sodium and chlorine are different atoms or rather different ions. Okay, they cannot be treated at one point. Okay, if you remove your chlorine things and look only at the sodium ions, okay, then you will probably, you will get, in fact, possibly I will bring a structure and probably show you that in that particular case, if you look only at sodium ions, you will see that sodium ions are placed in a face centered cubic positions. So, you must start with a face centered cubic lattice. Okay, each point of this particular lattice, let us say at origin, you put sodium ion and then you go, you start with iron atom and then you put at a point A by 2 I plus J plus K a chlorine and ion, then you will be getting a sodium chloride structure. probably, if I remember, I'll bring the next time a structure and try to show you how the sodium chloride structure can be thought of as a face-centered cubic structure. So it must start from face-centered cubic lattice, and it must contain two ions bases. At each of the point, you put one particular atom at origin and another atom at a distance of a by 2 I plus j plus k, and you generate a sodium chloride structure. Similarly, cesium chloride structure, if cesium and chlorine would have been identical, this would have formed a body-centered cubic structure. But cesium and chlorine are not the same atoms, so I cannot call it a body-centered cubic structure. I actually call it a simple cubic lattice with two atoms bases, or rather two ions bases. Okay? One ion again being put at origin, another ion being put at a by 2 I plus j plus k. Okay? See, in sodium chloride, we start with a face-centered cubic lattice, while in cesium chloride, I start with a simple cubic lattice. Now, diamond is another structure where you are having exactly two type of atoms bases, but both of them are exactly identical. Okay? Unlike sodium chloride or cesium chloride, where sodium is different from chlorine. In diamond, you have, you know, diamond is carbon. Okay? You have only carbon atoms, but these carbon atoms, if you just replace these carbon atoms by points, that will not form a Bravais lattice. So, if I have to look at diamond, if I have to describe the structure of diamond, I must describe a lattice and a basis. In fact, every structure is defined in terms of a Bravais lattice and a basis. When I take the Bravais lattice of diamond, it will be face-centered cubic lattice. And in the case of diamond, you start with a face-centered cubic lattice and put two carbon ions, one at origin, another at distance of a by 4 I plus j plus k. In fact, diamond structure, you put one atom at the origin, another at a by 4, remember a by 4 I plus j plus k, which is 1/4 the length of the body diagonal. This will give you a diamond structure. So, as we say, we start from a Bravais lattice, then we start talking about bases which consist of atoms or ions and generate a crystal structure. So, a crystal structure in principle is defined as, and you have to define two things, one is a Bravais lattice, another is the basis. Now, let us talk about the planes, because when we are going to talk about the X-ray crystallography, one thing which we always talk, as all of you know, we talk of the planes, because Bragg condition talks about the planes and the distance between the planes. So, let us first see what we mean by planes inside a lattice, because this is again an aspect in which I find students are somewhat confused. The thing is that a plane is something which you draw within a lattice. A plane is a plane, the standard plane, there is nothing special about that thing. But when I am talking of a plane inside a lattice, this must contain some lattice points. This must contain lattice points. In fact, every plane will consist infinite lattice points. Okay? It must pass through lattice points. I cannot think of a plane, I mean, when I am talking of a plane inside a crystal, I am not talking of a plane which does not contain any point. Okay? In principle, it is always possible to draw an imaginary plane, which is, let us say, between two points. For example, you know, let us take a two-dimensional structure. So, you have here, you have point here, you have point here, you have point here. Okay? I can imagine a plane which is something like this. Of course, in two dimensions, it will be a line. Okay? This does not contain any point. Now, this, according to me, is not a valid line or a valid plane. Okay? But a line like this, which is passing through these lattice points, does represent a proper line or a proper plane. So, a particular line or plane in three dimension and a line in two dimension must contain lattice points. Then only we call it a normal plane. Whenever we are talking of the planes, okay, it always must contain points. We say many set of planes can be drawn through lattice points. Planes must contain lattice point. Then by symmetry, because remember, our starting point of Bravais lattice is that the lattice has a perfect translational symmetry. So, if a plane has to pass through a point, okay, then through every point, a parallel plane can always be drawn. Okay? So, every lattice point, through every lattice plane, a parallel plane has to pass. So, I am giving an example here. For example, this is just taking a two-dimensional thing. It is easier to draw two-dimensional lattice. If you are more keen on three-dimensional thing, you can imagine that this structure is also moving in the third direction out of the plane of the paper. Okay? And these lines are no longer, but a plane like this. Okay? For example, I have drawn one set of planes or one set of lines which are like this. Now, These are parallel lines. Similarly, you can draw a parallel line which is passing through these planes. Similarly, through every plane you can draw a parallel line, okay, which will pass through some of the plane. Remember, this line or this plane will not pass through all the points. It will pass through some of the points, but nevertheless, because this lattice is infinite, so this will contain infinite points. Okay, but a parallel line or parallel plane must pass through every point. So through this particular point also, exactly parallel plane must pass. Now this is another set of planes which I have drawn. Okay, joining this particular point to this particular point. Now there is another set of planes which is parallel to this, which is also passing through these lines. Similarly, you can imagine of another plane which is passing through this particular points. Okay, of course, there will be a point somewhere here to which it will join, something like this. Okay, so basic question is that a particular plane must pass, must contain a point, and through every point a parallel plane must pass. Then we will call these as the planes inside a lattice. Now, in order to identify a set of parallel planes, what is important word is a parallel planes. Remember, we are always, when I am drawing Miller indices of a plane, we are always characterizing the set of parallel planes. It is not just one plane. One plane generally does not have a meaning because of symmetry, because of translation symmetry. Whatever happens to this particular plane has to happen for any other parallel plane through any other lattice points, because all points are equivalent there. I mean, there is absolutely no difference between these points. Their environments are exactly identical. So the way a particular point is going to behave, exactly the same way another point is also going to behave. That's what is the starting point of a Bravais lattice. Okay? So this Miller indices is used to characterize a set of parallel planes, because we many times, especially in X-ray diffraction, we have to talk from which particular plane this diffraction has come. Okay, we have to identify these planes. Okay, and therefore, when I say a plane, it always means a set of parallel planes. So this is used to characterize a set of parallel planes, and this is the way we do it. Probably all of you know about it, because this generally, I am sure you must be teaching at some of the things, and even otherwise at high schools people give the idea of Miller indices. Okay, but just to complete the story, I am giving this concept of Miller indices. Take intercepts on one of the planes of the set of along suitable set of axes. I think this language is little odd. Take intercepts of one of the planes. Okay, what I am saying, that out of the parallel planes you choose one of the plane. Okay, take that particular plane and find out intercept on a set of suitable axes. Okay, these suitable axes, for example, could be your primitive vectors themselves, A, B, C. Sometimes we may not use this primitive vectors, as I will be discussing later. Okay, to emphasize symmetry, I may use a slightly different type of vectors. For example, when I am talking of, let's say, body centered cubic or face centered cubic, I often draw in terms of x, y, z. Okay, or in other words, I convert these lattices into simple cubic lattices, as I said just now, said how to convert. We have just discussed this aspect, and using that particular way express these, you know, set of axes, okay, these intercepts with those set of axes. Okay, generally from the reference of context, it's clear whenever I am talking of a particular plane, what are the axes with respect to which I am defining these planes. Sometimes there could be ambiguity, then it's important to tell you, when I am talking, defining these planes, which are the set of axes that I am taking, choosing which I am defining these planes. So take intercepts of one of the planes of this particular set along a suitable set of axes and express in terms of lattice constant. So I am giving you just example later. Take reciprocal of these numbers, multiply by a suitable number to make the numbers integer with no common factors. Okay, this is important. Often in X-ray crystallography, we also give a planes which are common factors. We also talk of 2-2-2 planes or 3-3-3 planes, okay, which means slightly different. Okay, if you have time, we will discuss in the when we are discussing the X-ray crystallography. So this is a simple example. You know, let's suppose we are talking of this particular plane which is here. All right, let's suppose these are three axes. These need not be even mutually perpendicular to each. Okay, it could be just some of the axes of our choice. So let's suppose this is one axis, and the intercept here is twice lattice constant. In fact, intercept may not be even at one particular lattice constant, depends on what type of plane you are talking. But as I am saying, taking this a simple example, so you have intercept here as 2a here, then along the b direction, which is I am calling as the second direction here, you have intercept as 4b, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, this distance and this distance need not be same, okay, because this lattice need not be really cubic lattice. Then along the third direction, which is c direction, the intercept is this 3 times c. So this is intercept is 2a, this intercept is 4b, this intercept is 3c. Now I remove abc because I have to express this in terms of lattice constant. So I will just call this as 2, 4, 3. then take the reciprocals. Okay. The reciprocal will be 1 upon 2, 1 upon 4, 1 upon 3. Then you multiply by a suitable number to convert this as 3 numbers. Okay. In fact, and there should not be a common factor and there should be no fraction. So, you will find that the number which I need to multiply it by is 12. If I multiply it by 12, this becomes 6, this becomes 3, this becomes 4. So, Miller index of this particular plane will be called 634. So, this is a 634 plane. And remember, the finite set of parallel planes which all will have Miller indices 634. Just to give an example, if you are talking of simple cubic lattice, this is 100 plane. In fact, this is the plane to which x direction is normal. So, you can see the intercept along the x direction is lattice constant. Along the y direction and z direction, the intercepts will be infinite. If I take invert of infinite, I will get 0. So, 1 upon 1, 1 upon infinity, 1 upon infinity. So, this becomes 1, 0, 0. So, this is the 1, 0, 0 plane in simple cubic lattice. This is what will be 1, 1, 0 plane, which divides the cube into the half diagonally. Okay. You can see intercept along x direction is A. Intercept along y direction is A, intercept along c direction is infinite because c, this c direction will never intersect this particular plane. So, if you take the reciprocal, it will become 1, 1, 0. So, this is 1, 1, 0 plane. You take 1, 1, 1 plane, this is 1, 1 plane. You take the corner, you take this corner, join these three. This is 1, 1, 1 plane. Okay, you can see the intercept along the x direction is A, y direction is A, z direction is also A. So, this is actually a 1, 1, 1 plane of a simple cubic lattice. Sometimes we have to give the directions also. An electron moves in this particular direction. So, we have to tell in which direction it moves with the crystal structure. So, we have to many times define directions. In fact, even the band structures and many properties of the solid depend in the which direction I am trying to look for them. All right. So, there are indices here. These are much more simpler than the Miller indices because here I do not take any reciprocal. If I have a direction can always be represented by a vector quantity. So, if I have a direction of UA plus VB plus WC, where A, B, C are any three vectors appropriately chosen. For example, these could be primitive vectors or these could be what we call as often a conventional vectors. Then, in this case, UVW written in a square bracket. Remember, in the case of Miller indices for plane, I had written this that in a smaller bracket. If you write this in square bracket, this UVW will be the direction or will be the index for the direction. There are some other conventions also. In fact, many times we have to represent a set of equivalent planes. For example, let us talk of a cubic structure. Now, what I am calling the x direction in a cube, I could have called as a y direction or I could have called as a z direction because all these three directions have to be equivalent purely by symmetry. Okay, whatever happens along the x direction would also happen along the y direction, would also happen along the z direction because these are 100% symmetrical directions. There is nothing which is different. I mean, whatever I am calling the x direction, I could have called as a y direction, my lattice constant would not have changed, nothing would have changed. All right. So, whatever property I expect along in the 100 plane, I will also expect that same property in 010 plane or 001 plane. Okay. So, these planes, for example, could be all equivalent planes, planes like 100, 010 or 00, but let us talk of planes. All right. Now, whatever property happens along 100 plane will also happen along 010 and will also happen along 001 direction. So, if I have to talk for all three of them together, I use a slightly different index and then I write this as 100 plane. If I write this with a curly bracket, essentially it means that 100 or all its equivalent directions. This equivalent direction has to be referred from the point of view of symmetry. Okay. I have given you example of a cubic lattice which has the highest symmetry. If the symmetry goes down, okay, then accordingly appropriately chosen equivalent planes will be referred by 100 putting in curly bracket. Similarly, if I am looking at equivalent directions, see whatever happens along 100 direction should also happen along 010 direction, then I write this into angular bracket. So, this will be 100 directions. So, this is what we said. a set of equivalent planes. Equivalent word has to be looked from the point of view of reference of context, okay, can be written as curly bracket HKL. Similarly, a set of equivalent direction, again equivalent being defined depending upon what type of crystal structure you are talking, will be written into the angular bracket UVW. So, UVW represent a set of direction, not only UVW, but also equivalent of UVW. Then I come to the concept of unit cell. Unit cell is a very, very important thing. See, advantage of defining a Bravais lattice is that most of the time you define a property within a particular volume of a space and you just translate this particular thing over the entire space. So, a particular volume of the space, if it is translated through all the primitive vectors of the lattice, all the translation vectors of the lattice, if it fills this space completely without leaving any void and without any overlap, then this particular unit cell is called a primitive unit cell. So, as I said, a volume in three dimension, when translated through all possible translation vectors, fills the entire space without any overlap and without any voids, okay, is called a primitive unit cell. Unfortunately, there are many ways of representing a unit cell. There are multiple possibilities, okay. You have to normally appropriately choose some of these things, okay. But also, it must contain on the average of one particular point. Let me just give you some example of a two-dimensional structure. So, that just to, for example, if you are having a set of points, let us say square lattice, that is what we had considered earlier. For example, this could be one of the unit cell. All right. If you translate this way, this way, this way, or this way, okay, it completely fills this space. You translate to any of the translation vectors. Okay. For translation vectors, I have defined only for three dimension. If I want to choose two directions, then I have to take only two vectors. You know, it will be only, there will be two primitive vectors, A and B, not in the same line. Okay, and then you will have only two integers, N1 and N2. If you are talking one dimension, then there will be only one vector. Alright, so translate through any of the primitive vectors here and then you will be able to fill the space completely. Now, this could be one of the primitive unit cell. For example, this could be another possibility of primitive unit cell, which will have exactly the same condition. So, there are multiple ways of having a primitive unit cell which will represent the same lattice. Now, depends on your convention, depends on your choice, which you would like to use as your unit cell. Okay, of course, as I said, it must contain one point on the average. Let me just come back to this particular figure. See, I would like to mention here that it contains only one point on the average. See, here if you look at this thing, it is very clear that it contains only one point on the average. Here if you look at this particular corner, there are four corners, alright, in this unit cell, but each one of them is being shared by four squares, one square here, another square here, third square is fourth square here. So, therefore, when I am taking on the average this particular point, only 1/4 has to be accounted. When I account 1/4 and there are four such points, so on the average I will get one particular point per unit cell. Now, often to emphasize symmetry, I do not use a primitive unit cell, but I choose a unit cell which is of dimension n times primitive unit cell, or a volume n times primitive unit cell where n is an integer. Okay. This is what we call as a conventional unit cell. So, a conventional unit cell is a volume in three dimension when translated through a subset, not all possible vectors, but through a subset of all possible translation vectors, fills the entire space without any overlap and without any void. This is often used to emphasize symmetry. For example, whenever we are talking of body centered cubic lattice and face centered cubic lattice, we always draw a simple cubic unit cell, because that is little more convenient. It is again putting back the same words that I represent a body centered and a face centered cubic lattice as a simple cubic lattice. Alright. So, we just write a simple cubic unit cell, okay, or a cubic unit cell. Okay, remember, a conventional unit cell which is of the form of a cube for a body centered cubic lattice will contain two points on the average, while in the case of face centered cubic lattice it will contain four points. Now, in fact, there are examples which I will not work it out, which you can always see. In fact, most of the textbook this has been given, so I will not go into the detail. In three dimensions there can be 14 different type of Bravais lattices. When we say and these are classified in 7 crystal systems. When we talk of crystal systems and lattices, okay, they are always defined by the symmetry. Okay. In principle, you take the least symmetrical lattice and every lattice will turn out to be a special case of that particular lattice. We don't go by that. Whenever the symmetry becomes higher, we try to talk of a different lattice. So, for example, out of all these 14 Bravais lattices, cubic lattices have the highest symmetry. Okay. In fact, generally in crystallography, if you have a proper course of crystallography, they will talk about what are these particular symmetries, and using those symmetries, they will define crystal systems and crystal lattice type. It becomes more of a problem of group theory. But at this particular point, we will just say that we just take this result from that particular crystallography thing, and we say that in 3 dimension there can be 14 Bravais lattices and 7 crystal systems. There are 3 cubic lattices which we have already defined: body centered cubic, face centered cubic, and simple cubic. And this, along with what we will call later as hexagonal close pack, which is not really a Bravais lattice, okay, a very large number of solids crystallize in one of these lattices. So, this, I mean, in a first course on crystallography, most of the time we talk only of these lattices, no other lattices. But of course, there are many other lattices which are actually present. Many complicated solids have, or many complicated structures can be much more difficult than just simple cubic, just cubic or hexagonal structures. Now, we come to the last part of this particular topic, which is actually a very interesting thing, which we call as a close-packed structures. These close-packed structures are of interest because of multiple reasons. Okay. These are the structures which actually form, which waste least amount of space when we are forming these structures. See, earlier I had mentioned in this particular lecture that's not a very good idea. In fact, that is generally misconception among students, thinking that these are atoms which are just lying two here and there is a small line which is joining these two. It's not a correct picture. A slightly better picture is to treat these atoms hard spheres which touch each other. Actually, treating them as hard sphere is also not correct, because then we cannot consider the vibrations. Okay, so they are strictly speaking not hard, they are somewhat elastic. But as I said, we start from the simplest thing, and when we talk of crystallography, we generally talk in terms of the assuming that these atoms are hard spheres and they touch each other. So we do not have that type of concept. We are talking so this picture is not a correct picture in that sense that you have atom, at the most you can say there is the center of the atom, but you cannot imagine that your atom is so tiny and there is a big bond which is trying to form this thing. A much better picture would be something like this. It's touching. Now, when you assume that these atoms are sphere, there is also always going to be certain amount of space here, for example, which is going to be wasted, where there is not going to be an atom. So, assume atom as hard sphere and then try to find out a structure where you waste least amount of space, okay, which is packed to the maximum extent. And when we talk of closed structures, remember we are talking of single atom. Of course, you can get a better packing if you have multiple atoms and a tiny atoms fill this particular small space which is being created as a void here. Okay. But when we talk of a general close pack structures, we mean only those structures, okay, in which there is only one type of atom. So, I consider a solid with only one type of atom. Assume atoms to be hard spheres. Okay. We want to create structures which are packed closest. Okay. Now, let us try to do this in one dimension. So, this is a hard sphere. This is another hard sphere. And if you have only one dimension, if you have only one line, there is only one possibility that you can always put these atoms such that they touch each other. Okay, so, you will not like to create a gap between these two. These atoms must touch each other so that they waste least amount of space in one dimension. Now, let us assume that you have created one line of atoms like this, infinite line. You have another similar lines. Now, you want to put it on the top here at the bottom and want to create it in two dimension. Now, if I put another line and put this line on the top of each, so that these are just above it. So, you have another line where the atom is here, another atom is here. Then you can see the amount of space that is going to be wasted here is going to be extremely large. So, better would be take similar type of line and push it slightly on the right hand side or on the left hand side, so that this particular bottom part of the sphere actually comes and fits here. If it fits here, then the amount of space that you are going to waste is going to be exceedingly small. So if I have to pack in two dimension, I take a similar line and put another line so that this line is displaced by half the distance here, from here to here, it actually comes here. Okay. So you can see that particular thing coming here, which is like this. So I started with a line, okay. You put another line on the top of it, okay. This has been displaced this way. Okay. So this is forming a triangle. Okay. Now you can see that the amount of space, this we call as a dimples, small dimples. Okay. Each atom, this each sphere is surrounded by 6 dimples. Okay. In fact, you can see that this is forming a hexagonal type of structure. Simple hexagonal type of structure. There is also an atom here. All right. So this, the amount of space that is wasted here is least if I am putting this atom here. If I would have displaced this atom here and put on the top of it, okay, that time this particular dimples would have been much, much larger. Okay. So just by pushing it slightly this side. So this is in two dimension forming a closed pack structure. Of course, you can assume that fourth line which is going to be put, this is again going to be put so that this displaced like this. So it will be a similar line which is going to be put here. Okay. So this line exactly identical is going to be put here. Then this line exactly identical line is going to be put here. Okay. This is the way you are going to create a closed packing in two dimension. So all I wanted to say that you look at this particular thing, the center of these atoms, these are actually forming hexagonal simple structure. You not only have points here, center, but you also have one center here, which you know forms a Bravais lattice, as I have been mentioning earlier. If this point was not there, then this would have been honeycomb structure, which does not form a Bravais lattice, but here you have this particular point, and therefore, this does form a hexagonal Bravais lattice. And remember, there are 6 triangles within one hexagon. Now, question is that, if I want to now go into the third dimension, then I take similar type of close packed two dimensional structure, put on the top of this. If I want to put on the top of it, I will have 2 possibilities that I will show in the next picture. One possibility, I mean, it's very clear that if I have to put, I cannot put just exactly on the top of it, then again I am going to waste a lot of space. So the center of the atom which is on the top line, if it is occupying, if it is just placed above this particular dimple, then in that particular case, you will waste lesser amount of space. So next plane of atoms, I am going to put so that the center lies here. But if I put one atom on the top of here, because this is going to be sort of spherical, okay, I will not be able to put another atom at here. This is what I will also show in the next picture. Okay. So you can put atoms in such a fashion that it occupies only the alternative dimples. So if you put one atom on the top here, then the second atom will come here, third atom will come here. So only alternates of the dimples, or what I will call, the atoms has to be put at the top of this particular triangle. So only on the alternate triangles you will be able to put this particular atoms. You will not be able to put the atoms on each triangle, because this particular sphere is going to occupy a certain amount of volume. All right. Now there are 2 possibilities. Either I put in such a fashion that the center occupies this, then I will not be able to put an atom on the top of it here. Second possibility is that I put one atom on the top here, but then I will not be able to put atom here. Only on the alternate dimples I will be able to put the atoms. So there are 2 possibilities in which I could create this particular directions, 3-dimensional structure, which I am showing in the next transparency. So this is one of the ways, which the first one I call as A, second one I call as B. So you see, this is a yellow thing, and I have put it slightly transparent so that you can see the dimple behind it. So I have put this particular atom, which is exactly identical atom, on the top of this dimple. But then I cannot put here, because if I had to put it here, then again this is going to occupy this space, which is not possible. So here I put one atom on the top of this dimple. On the second one, then I am putting alternate one. Then I could not put an atom on the top of this dimple. Then now I am putting atom on the top of this dimple. So alternate of the dimples are being left out. This has been left out, on this I have put. This has been left out, on this I have put. This one has been left out, on the top of this I have put. So only on the alternate of these dimples I have been able to put the points. Okay. This let's call as AB. So first one was A position, second one was B position. Now this could have been another way. I could not, need not have chosen these dimples, I would have chosen these dimples. The situation will be slightly different. This will be slightly displaced. But that was also a exactly possible way. So let's look at the second possibility. Now this particular dimple has been left out. On this dimple I have put one atom. Now this has been left out. On this particular dimple I have put an atom. This has been left out. On this particular dimple I have put on the atoms. So this is exactly similar type of thing, but then the alternate input that I am using is become different. So earlier I had put here, but not here. Now I have put it here, but then I cannot put it here. So this situation I will call alternate. I am using only alternate triangles. So I had used one of the set, I have used now another set. So this I am calling is AC. Okay. Now let's imagine that I have chosen first as AB. Now I have to put third one. When I put the third one, again I have possibilities of two types. So let's suppose I have put this, or let's say AC, it doesn't matter. Okay. Now if I have to put on this particular thing, I will have again two possibilities. Either I use these crosses as dimples. If I put, take another plane and put on the top of it, this particular atom, if it lies above here, it cannot lie above here. Okay. So either I choose this crosses where I am going to put this third layer such that the center of the atom lie here, then this will occupy, will get occupied, this will get occupied, this will get occupied. I mean, remember, this is the third dimension on the top one. Okay. Then these will not get occupied. Or I put exactly like what I have said, I put on these dimples, which are also alternate dimples. Okay. So either I choose these blue ones, okay, with a cross within, or I use this particular red one with a cross arm, just a simple cross. So either I choose these particular things or I choose these particular things. Now, just I wanted to point out certain things. If I decide to put on these red crosses, okay, this was my original A thing, this turns out to be exactly on the top of the first layer. So you have first layer, then second layer and the third layer, which is exactly on the top of it. On the other hand, if I decide to put on this particular thing, this is not coming on the top of any of these original spheres on the layer A. This is on the dimples which were left out. So remember, in the earlier case here, these dimples were left out. Now I can put another set of layers on which, such that the atoms are on the top of this dimple which was the left out dimple. Or I can choose this one. If I choose this one, this will be exactly on the top of the A atoms. All right. So you have two possibilities of putting the third layer. Remember, this is the third layer I am putting. So I can either put here or I can put here. Now, in this particular thing, I mean, there are both the possibilities existing, which will give rise to two different type of structures, as we will be talking just now. Let's assume that I am putting on the dimples which have been left out. If I am not putting on the top of the A layers, but this layer, third layer, is being put on the dimples which have been left out when I had put the second layer. Okay. In that particular case, this is what the situation would look like. So this was your originally first A layer. Okay, this I had called it C, but you can call it B, doesn't matter, because B and C is always relative. Now the blue, the third one things have been put on the, all these are not on the top of green. You remember, you can see this has been put now on the top of this left out dimples. So this has been put on the left out dimples. This has been put out on the left out dimples. Remember, this yellow was put here. This was left out. On the top of this, this is the blue. Okay, this, on this particular thing, there was an atom. Okay, now this particular thing, as you see here, this was the original blue and yellow. This was left out, so I had put a green thing. Next, third one, there was a yellow here, so I have not put a point here. Fourth one was left out here. On this, I have put it here. All right. So there are two different ways of putting. This is what we call as ABC type of stacking. If I have put this particular layer, which was exactly on the top of green, okay, this I would have called ABA type of, because you have gone down the third layer, which is exactly on the top of the first layer. But remember, all these will give me the closest packing. The packing fraction, as we call it, will be exactly identical in both these cases, because the amount of space that you are going to waste is exactly identical. Now, this is what we call as two type of close packed structures. If you have a stacking of AB, AB, AB type, this is what we call as a hexagonal closed packed structure, which, as I will just now be telling, does not form a Bravais lattice. And if I have a structure which is called ABC, ABC, ABC type, the one which I have shown you, then we call this as a cubic closed packed structure, and this is exactly identical to what we call as a face centered cubic lattice. How? I'll just now show. Actually, it's very simple to see that this is a hexagonal closed packed structure, because you can see the hexagons here. The problem when we are talking of FCC lattice, you don't see these hexagons, because you have to reorient themselves to make them cubic. Now let us look at this. This was an FCC unit cell which I have drawn. Okay. Now if you look at this point, which is at this particular face center, you look at this particular point, which is at this face center, you have this point, you have point this and you point this, okay. All right. So, what is important is to realize that in face centered cubic structure, 1 1 1 plane, this is the 1 1 1 plane. If you join here, this will be the plane here. This is the 1 1 1 plane, which is the closest pack. So, why don't we see that cubic structure when I am describing this close packed structure from that particular thing? Because I am not, I have to reorient, I have to change this particular direction to see this cubic symmetry. So, it is easier to see the other way. You start with a face centered cubic structure and you say that on this particular, and you can see visualize this particular hexagons. But this atom will come on the top of this particular triangle, this angle will come on the top of this particular triangle, exactly on the top when I am looking at the 1 1 1 orientation. So, you can see it is not unfortunately so easy to see in this picture. If you have 3-dimensional picture, it is comparatively easier to see these aspects, all right. So, you can see this particular hexagon and you can see visualize that face centered cubic is actually representing a closed packed structure. Okay, and the close pack plane is 1 1 1. What I have drawn as the original plane is actually the 1 1 1 plane of this face centered cubic lattice. Now, this is my last transparency. The hexagonal close packed structure does not form a Bravais lattice. Actually, it can be represented as a hexagonal Bravais lattice. Okay, in hexagonal Bravais lattice, you have one hexagon and another hexagon exactly on the top of it. That is what is hexagonal Bravais lattice, which actually is a Bravais lattice. There is no position, no in between points. Okay. So, this can be represented as a hexagonal Bravais lattice with 2 points basis, one atom, one point being put at the origin and another point at A by 3 plus B by 3 plus C by 2, which happens to be, and ABC has to be appropriately defined, which I am sorry I have not defined it. Okay, probably I will give you the, okay, or let me just mention this thing. So, if you take in plane hexagonal, okay, this is hexagon in the plane, you put exactly another hexagon on the top of it, you will be generating hexagonal Bravais lattice. Okay. Now, A, there are 2 conventions of defining A, either you take this as A, okay. The one which I have used here is to choose this as B and C is this particular vector on the top, which joins this particular plane exactly on the top of it. Sometimes instead of taking this B, people take this as B. Okay. Now, if you go A by 3, you come here in this particular direction, 1/3 of the way, then you move 1/3 of the way in this particular direction B, you come here at the center of the triangle. So, if you are forming, if you take this particular triangle by going A by 3 in this direction, going A by 3 in this direction, you come at the center of this particular triangle. Now, you go half the way between these 2 layers, then you center this particular point. Okay. So, that is what is, I mean, this is your, this was your, what was your B layer, and this particular C will be distance between one A layer and the second nearest A layer. Okay. So, this is what will be giving you a Bravais lattice with 2 points basis, one point here, another point at the prism that you will consider. In fact, if you have this triangle extended on the top, this will be generating a prism. So, that particular prism, alternate of these prism will be centered. So, this is represents a hexagonal Bravais lattice with 2 points basis, another first at origin, another at A by 3 plus B by 3 plus C by 2. I think I will end. We can probably entertain a few questions. OP Jindal Institute, Raigad.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, that slide number 4.
Yeah. Yes.
Just my question is,
yeah,
can we draw the, here you have drawn for the 2D. Am I right?
Yes, sir,
for the
right.
SSC.
Yeah.
Yeah. But can we draw for any shape like as a cuboid, rectangle or any other?
Yeah, you can also have a rectangular lattice. For example, this A and B need not be same. This can also be hexagonal lattice, example of which I have given as 2-dimension. Okay. There are multiple ways. Okay, I do not remember how many, but you know, there is a certain number of different type of Bravais lattices you can have in 2-dimension. I do not remember that number. But if you look at some of the books, you know, you can tell how many number of lattices are possible. Okay. But you are right, this is only one of the examples. But you know, for example, I give you a centered thing. There is also possibility of hexagon, which I have given you today morning. Okay, this can also be rectangular where A and B are not same. All these will form the Bravais lattice.
Symmetry, yeah, can be observed from any point of...
Yeah, see, the basic idea of a Bravais lattice is that all lattice points are equivalent. So, you look at any particular lattice point and start looking at the symmetry.
Okay, okay. Now, second question, sir. Already you have mentioned four particular structure, the FC, BCC, NACL, FCC.
Yes.
But my questions, how we can find out the four FE, it is BCC, for NACL is FCC.
Okay.
Can you elaborate more?
Because the only way I can find, I'm not the only way, there are many ways, okay, but one of the important ways by which I can find the crystal structure is by using X-ray diffraction. Okay, so I'll show you using X-ray diffraction how I can distinguish between a face-centered cubic structure or a body-centered cubic structure or a simple cubic structure. Okay, so in fact, if you take a sodium chloride and look at the structure, you will indeed find it to be possessing all the properties of a FCC structure and not of a simple cubic structure.
Okay, okay. By some XRD as well as some experimental way only you can define, yes, this is the structure of that.
That's
one.
Right.
Likewise.
That's right, that's right. You are right, 100% right.
Yes. Now, sir, one more question, very simple.
Yeah, please.
Sir, already you have the 37, slide number 37, sir.
Okay.
Here we have drawn the close pack structure, am I right?
Yeah, you are right.
Okay, and it is in a three layer form.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes, sir. But my question is, sir, is there whatever the space between the two atoms,
yes,
still it is... it will be completely vacant or it will be filled up by some material or something?
There is some space which will always remain vacant. In fact, you can calculate the packing fraction. This is a problem which we ask students to do it. Okay, the packing fraction is about 74%, if I remember right. Okay, it means still you have 26% of the space which is wasted. Now, in principle, I mean, it does happen. For example, if you take a diatomic material, you know, it's possible that if you have a very tiny atom, you can fill in that particular case and you can have structures which are closer packed, but not with a single type of atom. If you have multiple type of atoms, it may be possible that that vacant state can be filled by a very, very tiny atom.
Okay, thanks so much, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah,
I have a question, basic question. In the first slide, you have explained that diamond has two bases with two FCC lattices. I have a small doubt.
Yeah, please.
Whether you are a diamond is filled only with carbon atoms, and how can you justify that it has two bases? Can you please explain that, sir?
Okay, see, what happens, the diamond structures can be looked into various type of ways. Okay, one of the ways which is normally given in the textbook is that you take two FCC lattices which are exactly identical, okay, put one on the top of them, displace another lattice with respect to the first lattice along the body diagonal, distance of A by 1/4 of the body diagonal. Then you create a diamond structure, okay, which is given in the almost all the textbook. The way I like to explain to the students, which is somewhat little more sort of comfortable, I will put it like, okay, let me just try to draw this particular thing. So I'm just drawing a cubic unit cell. All right, let's assume this is face centered. So you have points everywhere, you know, you have points here, here, and all the face center, which I am not drawing all of them to make picture simple. Now what you do, you divide this particular unit cell into 8 parts by taking, let's say, half of this distance. So you have half of this, okay, go A by 2, okay, you go A by 2 here, okay, go A by 2 here, generate a smaller type of So, this cube has a length of A by 2 and there will be 8 such cubes, okay. You have 8 such cubes which is filling the entire space. Now, if you start from this particular point and go A by 4 distance of body diagonal, this small cube will be centered, all right, which is the cube of length A by 2. So, a diamond structure can be looked as, you start with the FCC lattice, FCC unit cell, cubic unit cell. Then divide this particular unit cell into 8 smaller unit cell, okay. Then alternate of these particular unit cell will be centered. If this is centered, next one will not be centered. Then this will be centered, next one will not be centered, okay. So you can generate this particular structure from FCC where you are putting one point here, another point at this particular point. Then you start from this particular point, take one particular point, put another point here. You start from this particular point, put one point here, another point here. So you take FCC lattice and at each point you put at this origin and you put one point here, another point at the center of a smaller cube which has a dimension of a by 2, or rather which has a edge of a by 2. Yeah, please go ahead. Is it clear?
Yes, sir, clear, sir. It's clear for me, sir. Thank you, sir.
Walchand College, please. Sangli.
How to calculate density of lattice point for a particular plane?
What do you mean by density of lattice points? You want total number of points per unit you sell? That's very easy. Or you want to find out packing fraction?
In X-ray diffraction pattern, yeah, for a particular peak, yeah, we get higher intensity.
That's right.
The reason is, for a particular plane, the density of atoms or lattice points are large.
I understand what is your question. First of all, it is not correct that the intensity depends on the number of atoms per on that particular plane. This is not correct. In fact, this is what I am going to discuss tomorrow. There are two major factors. One which you call is a structure factor, another is what is called atomic form factor. The intensity of a particular X-ray beam, X-ray plane lies on both these factors. Okay, not just on the atomic geometrical factor, but also on how X-rays are getting diffracted from various type of electrons and their wave function. So, it's a little more complex. The intensities to explain in terms of the density of planes are not very easy. But if you at all want to find out the density of the planes, that's not all that difficult. For example, look at 111 plane. Okay, now, what you have to find out, if you want to really find out what is the density points on this particular plane, you look at this particular triangle. Okay, take this particular triangle, find out what is the area of this particular triangle. How many points this particular thing contains? This contains this particular point, it contains this particular point, it contains this particular point. All right, find out on the average how many, this angle is 60 degrees, so this particular thing is being actually shared by six similar planes. Okay, now looking at that particular thing, similarly here, so you can find how many number of points are on the average lying on this particular triangle. Okay, remember you have to account for sharing of each point by equivalent planes. Okay, then find out the area. You can always calculate the total number of points per unit area on any given plane. That's not a very difficult exercise. Okay, you can even talk about, you know, how much of the area is occupied and all these problems we generally ask our students to do in the condensed matter physics course. Okay, but what I wanted to tell you is that the intensity of X-ray line does not depend on this factor alone. There are other factors also which are important for determining the intensity of the lines.
Sir, yeah, in cubic structure,
yeah,
the atoms are at the corners of the cube is called as a primitive shell.
Yeah.
And but in the hexagonal packed structure, maybe the atoms are at the corners of the cube is called as a primitive shell. But atoms per cell in cube and hexagonal packed structure, there are different. So, how it is called as primitive cell?
Okay, see, think that in a primitive unit cell has to be defined for any given type of lattice. All right. Now, when I am talking of, let's say, hexagonal close packed structure, unfortunately, this does not form a lattice. Okay, so I cannot call off a unit cell of that lattice. Now, what is actually the lattice type? Okay, see, in that case, for HCP structure, I have to consider a Bravais lattice and I have to consider a basis. Now, what you can show is the unit cell of the lattice, okay, not of the hexagonal structure. Now, if you show that unit cell will be like a prism, this triangle you extend from A point to another A point. Okay, it will contain two atoms of, let's say, whatever material, for example, cobalt crystallizes in HCP. Okay, but see, if you just replace cobalt by each of these atoms, that unfortunately will not form a Bravais lattice. All right. Now, also, for example, for cubic, when I am talking of face-centered cubic, the cube that I am drawing is not a primitive unit cell. It's a conventional unit cell. All right. Primitive unit cell must contain one point, while FCC structure that we draw face-centered cubic will contain on the average 4 points. Okay. If you insist on drawing a primitive unit cell for face-centered cubic, you can draw it. But generally, we do not draw it because that will turn out to be very asymmetric and odd-shaped. Okay, while it's much more simpler to understand when we have drawn a cubic structure. So, we do not mind ignoring the idea of primitive unit cell and talking only in terms of conventional unit cell to describe the structure. All right, I hope I have answered the question. Don Bosco, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I have two questions.
Yeah.
The first question is,
yeah,
you have shown that when you are finding the Miller indices,
yes,
you are using the intercepts that the planes make with the x, y and z axis.
It need not be x, y, z. Let me correct. It need not be x, y, z direction. It could be any three directions.
if the plane contains the entire one of the axes lies in the plane itself,
you take a parallel,
you take a parallel plane,
does not matter. You take one plane which is parallel to it. See, Miller indices always represent a set of parallel planes. Okay, don't take that plane, but take a plane which is parallel to it. For example, when I drew 100, I do not take really the XY plane or rather YZ plane. Because, you know, YZ plane, you know, the axis will be lying in this particular, that particular plane. So, I took a plane which is parallel to it.
Okay, sir. Sir, and my second question is,
yes.
This is actually just to satisfy an intellectual question.
Yeah, please.
So far the discussion,
yeah.
We have used Cartesian coordinate system. So, can we use maybe some other coordinate system to describe a lattice, like say spherical or cylindrical?
See, the thing is that we don't normally use spherical coordinate system because you do not have a spherical symmetry inside the solid. Okay, but the thing is that we definitely use different type of coordinate system. For example, if I am describing monoclinic or triclinic structure, okay, where the ABC primitive directions do not have 90 degree angle in between them. Or for them, for example, typical example of hexagonal which I have given you. In hexagonal, the A and B that I have defined, okay, are really not mutually perpendicular to each other. Okay, so I can define them into any trivial system which I personally feel. But spherical polar and cylindrical coordinate systems, because, you know, you do not have those type of sort of symmetries inside the material. See, remember, a crystal is a set of discrete points. A sphere is a continuous thing. I don't have that type of spherical symmetry here. Okay, so generally those type of coordinate systems are not used here.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. Okay, I think we'll close.